Well, hi there. Welcome once again to In Search of Christianity, brought to you by Bible Talk. And on behalf of Alice and myself and all of the Bible Talk team, we want to greet you in the wonderful, the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Yes, we do.
As we continue on in our study of the evidence of a redeemed life, looking into those things that show to the world the presence of Christ and his redemptive work in our lives.
Amen.
Because Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount, you shall know them by their fruit. So we're going to look, we talked about kindness in our last session, last two sessions actually. So we're going to pick it up today and talk about goodness, the next fruit of the Holy Spirit. All right? But before we do that, I'm going to ask my sweet patootie Alice over here to ask God's blessing on our time together.
Hallelujah. Father, we come before you. And we thank you and we praise you and we worship you. And we ask you, Lord, to guide and direct this word today that we share and that hearts would be open to receive it. And Lord, that nothing would come out of our mouths that isn't from you.
Amen.
And we just pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ.
Amen. All right. So as I said, we're talking about that fruit of the Holy Spirit. Goodness.
Goodness.
Goodness. So let me start out by repeating what the prophet Nahum said so long ago. The Lord is good.
Amen.
Nahum 1:7. That's not a rumor. That's a truth, right?
He is.
So the evidence of a redeemed life is simply the imitation of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Not a counterfeit. I'm talking about us driven by the power of the Holy Spirit to live, speak and live as Jesus Christ did. That's our idea. Paul wrote to the Ephesians and said, therefore be imitators of God as beloved children, right?
Mm-hmm.
And John, in his third letter, he wrote, beloved, do not imitate what is evil, but what is good. The one who does good is of God. The one who does evil has not seen God.
Mm-hmm.
In light of that imitation of Jesus, Paul writes in his letter to Titus, love what is good. That's Titus 1:8. And then he says, teach what is good. Titus 2:3. So our goal is to love what is good. And our goal today is to seek God that he would teach us what is good. Right? Well, let's start by dealing with a harsh reality. You're not good.
No.
Of course, by the same token, neither am I or Alice. What I am and what I desire to be is righteous. Now, that's what we're to be. We're to be righteous. That's never available through our goodness, but always available through his grace.
Amen.
All right? We're told by the word that we should be holy. And the Lord Jesus said that we should do good. So that's where we're going. We want to be holy
and
we want to do good.
Yes.
He said in the Sermon on the Mount, he said, let your light shine before men in such a way that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Matthew 5:16. What then is good? I mean, this, if you want to do good, or you have to know what it is.
That's right.
Well, how do we study? As Al said, well, as I said, that was me, right?
Yes.
No, that was Nahum. The Lord is good. That's
right.
Who is good.
That's right.
But he wants us to know
what
is good. Because, you see, the Lord never calls us to do something without teaching and equipping us to do that very thing.
Right.
So the Lord said, he has told you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God? Micah 6:8. How simple is that?
It is very simple. God's word is very simple.
He has told you, man, what is good.
Right.
So it is not, at least not here, a matter of opinion, all right? What you think or what I think. It's about what God thinks, about what God has spoken. It's about what God says, and he has revealed what he thinks.
Mm-hmm.
Good is about our behavior. Justice and kindness built upon a right relationship with God. That's what we said in Micah, right?
Yes.
So, and as Jesus said when he was answering the question of a scribe, when he said, "What is the foremost command?" Jesus said to him, "And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength." He went on to say, and the second is this, "You shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these." So, all right, that was easy. We're done.
Well, see you next week.
not quite yet, because there are other teachings and opinions that we need to be aware of, as the Apostle Paul states, in order that no advantage be taken of us by Satan. For we are not ignorant of his schemes. 2 Corinthians 2:11. So let's not be ignorant of his schemes. Let's not be ignorant of the attacks that come against what God has spoken to us, all right? In 1973, here in the United States, the Supreme Court, the highest court of the land, had a hearing called Miller versus California. It was a case on obscenity. And they ruled that the first test of immoral activity, obscenity, would be what the average person applying contemporary community standards thought. The determination of whether or not something is good or evil, then, according to the highest court in America, would be what the average person and the community he or she lives in finds to be acceptable.
Right.
Whatever they think is acceptable moral behavior, they are the judges. However, Jesus said, "The word I spoke is what will judge him at the last day," John 12:48. So obviously there is a conflict between what the world thinks and what the word says. Peter wrote this, "For by these," talking about that word of God, he said, "by these he has granted to us his precious and magnificent promises, so that by them you may become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world by lust. Now for this very reason also, applying all diligence, in your faith supply moral excellence, and in your moral excellence, knowledge." 2 Peter 1:4-5. Well, it's true that, you see, righteousness is about our relationship with the Lord, but morality is about our relationship with other people.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? That's very simple. However, you can't have a right relationship with other people without a right relationship with God.
That's right. That's right.
It is absolutely right. And this is what the world doesn't understand. Our relationship with the Lord, righteousness, supports our relationship with other people.
Mm-hmm.
If we remove that vertical, that relationship with God, then the horizontal, our relationship with other people, that's morality, will fall to the ground and crash.
Will fail.
Absolutely it will. You know, a good analogy, I mean, is picture in your mind a minute, a cross.
Mm-hmm.
The cross. How about that? Yes. The cross. With that vertical piece firmly planted in the ground.
On the rock.
Okay? Well, that represents your relationship, man and God, from here on earth to up in the sky, up to heaven, right?
Jesus is the one who made that relationship available.
Absolutely. And then you have the cross member, the relationship between man and man. Think of that cross with two men on either side of it, the two thieves. If you take away that upright piece, the vertical, the relationship with God, what happens to the horizontal? It collapses to the ground. It falls to the ground and crashes. So you have a choice. I mean, you're going to either accept God's determination of what is righteous and moral behavior, or the world's, the community standards, what the people think, right? Both of those have predetermined paths to achievement.
Yes.
Okay? Righteousness. There's only one path to righteousness.
Only one.
Only one. Mm-hmm. Jesus Christ said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but through me." John 14:6. There is no other way. I have heard all too many Christians in recent years say, "Well, if a person's a Hindu, but he's a really good Hindu, he's..." No.
It's not according to your works.
If a person is a Buddhist, but he's a really, really good Buddhist.
Mm-mm.
No. There's only one path to the Father, and that path is Jesus Christ.
That's right.
Now, having said that, I want to tell you this. God says he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him.
Yes, he is.
If some Buddhist wanders up a mountain looking for the guru, and he is seeking God, he is very likely to run smack dab into Jesus Christ on the top of that mountain.
If his heart's desire is to know God.
Because God searches a heart, and he is a rewarder of those who seek him. But if you seek what's to be had in those religions, it doesn't work.
It'll fail you.
Do not be fooled. Now, morality is purely conforming to an accepted standard of behavior.
Mm-hmm.
That's what morality is. Okay? It's acceptable to do this. You know, some truth is either subjective or objective.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Real truth is never subjective, but that's another story. In the issue of morality, then, the question becomes, who determines the standard? Okay? Who determines what is right morality? There's only three choices. It can only be one of three things.
Mm-hmm.
It can either be God sets the standard,
mm-hmm.
the individual sets the standard, or the community sets the standard. Those are the only three possibilities. So now in good Hebrew style, I'm going to work from the back forwards. Let's talk about the last one first, the community. Divine command theory is a theory which proposes that actions, their status as whether being moral or good, is equivalent to whether it's commanded by God. The theory asserts that what's moral is determined by what God commands, and that to be moral is to follow his commands. Followers of both monotheistic and polytheistic religions. Now, monotheistic is Christianity, Judaism, and Islam. Most all other religions, they have lots of gods. So followers of both in ancient and modern times have often accepted the importance of God's command in establishing morality. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to be a Christian
to be moral.
Well, to think that God has some good ideas about morality.
Mm-hmm.
All right? So that may sound good, and it may sound religious. Bear in mind that it doesn't actually require a right relationship with God.
Yeah.
Only a recognition that his commands in regards to men's relationship with each other are beneficial.
Right.
That they're beneficial. Most people who believe that America was founded as a Christian nation lose sight of this truth, okay? Many of the people who were the driving forces of the foundation of America, the American Revolution,
mm-hmm.
or the American Rebellion, depending on your point of view, Thomas Jefferson and Benjamin Franklin, for example, right? They were the power behind, so much of what happened in Revolution. They absolutely believed, and they held Scripture in high regard as to its moral teaching, but neither of them accepted the lordship and the atoning work of Jesus Christ in their own lives. See, you can look in the Bible and say, "Whoa, that's good." I do seminars on biblical principles in the workplace, and I've done them for secular companies. And I tell them right from the very, very beginning that everything that I'm going to teach comes out of the Bible. When I start to show them things out of the book of Proverbs in a business context, they say, "Oh, that makes perfect sense. That's good. That's good. That's good."
Because it does.
So they can accept those and start applying them in their life.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't require them
to be a Christian.
To be a Christian or accept the Lordship of Jesus.
Right.
Okay? Of course, that's the idea. The reason we have the seminars is to bring the truth of the word to them, leading them up to that place
mm-hmm.
where they go from looking at how the beauty of the word to the beauty of the word made flesh who dwelt among us. Okay.
Can I just interject here?
Yeah.
I was thinking about with Islam, the moral codes that they have are so stringent, and there are many women who are turning to the Muslim religion because of that.
Yeah, Alice is absolutely right. You know, We spent last year, we've traveled to a lot of, last year we were in 14 countries. We have traveled, we've had the opportunity to travel to a lot of places where it is predominantly Muslim.
Yes.
I mean, I have preached in towns and villages in Africa that were 99% Muslim. But Alice is right. I mean, we see this a lot in England. We saw it a lot.
Yeah, yeah.
Where, as she says, people are being
drawn by the morals.
Well, to the moral standards that they don't see, that they don't see in Christianity as it is made visible by the church today.
Amen. That's right.
It's true. I'm not going to get into the whole subject of, I look at so many young women who call themselves, who would call themselves Christian, dressed, I mean, absolutely immorally.
Absolutely.
We can get into the discussion of whether it's my view is subjective or objective. But the simple fact of the matter is, there are a lot of people becoming disgusted with the morals of this world, and rightly so. So, and by the way, this is one of the things that worked in favor of Adolf Hitler, for example, because he pointed out so many of the immoral things going on. This is one of the things that works, the enemy can use to his advantage when he starts to point out the immorality in the world around us. But the fact of the matter is, what is truly dependent on having that right life is righteousness. Yeah, that's what we talked about. Jefferson himself, he was very pessimistic about human nature.
Mm-hmm.
When he was so influential in the formation of the United States of America and liberty, he said himself, listen to this, the tree of liberty must be refreshed from time to time with the blood of patriots and tyrants. Because he didn't think it could work. Because of human nature, fallen human nature. He was intelligent enough to be able to look around him and see fallen human nature. But there's only one solution to fallen human nature, and that is to be lifted up to the heights by the Spirit of God.
Yes.
Man can't do that by himself. Man can't lift himself up out of that pit. Man can't lift himself up out of that miry clay. It takes the Lord God Almighty to lift us up out of that miry clay and set our feet upon a rock. I'm telling you, on a rock that is higher than I am.
Hallelujah.
So, alternatively, there are a lot of societies with little or no Christian influence who find a number of ways to establish moral standards. We generally think of governments without thinking that basically they are just ways that morality is defined and determined.
Mm-hmm.
They're called laws.
Yes.
They're called laws. That is the structuring of a moral code. Community is a conglomeration of individuals and therefore requires a majority consent.
Right.
Simple logic, right? However, think of these words of Jesus. Enter through the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is broad that leads to destruction. And there are many who enter through it. For the gate is small and the way is narrow that leads to life. And there are few who find it. Matthew 7:13-14.
Mm-hmm.
Many are on the road to destruction. Few on the road to life. That's what Jesus said. You know, Alice and I, we've been doing a lot of running around, doing a lot of errands, taking care of business. And the other day, yesterday, we stopped. We just stopped yesterday for lunch. We had a hot dog in a place, a fast food restaurant. And while we were there, the music was blaring away, which is pretty common in fast food restaurants now, because it seems like the music is aimed more towards the employees than towards the customers. But there was a song, and I mean, it was just blaring, and it shocked me to be sitting there. I'm having a hot dog, and I'm listening to this screaming. We're on a highway to hell. We're on a highway to hell. We're on a high, and it's over and over and over. I thought, well, is that the only lyric in the song? But it seemed like it. We're on a highway to hell. That was a very famous song. I mean, I didn't know it because I didn't pay attention to it. By the group AC/DC.
I've heard of AC/DC.
Well, that was their big, massive hit, On a Highway to Hell. They wrote it in 1979.
Wow.
So I don't want to be on a highway to hell. I wanted to stand up and scream, but I don't think I could have been heard over the music. Honestly, I'm on a highway to heaven. I'm on the path of righteousness. I don't want to be on a highway to hell. And how can you kind of celebrate this in song? Well, I got better hymns than that, I'll tell you what. The evidence of a redeemed life becomes visible as it does the increasing conflict between the commandment and culture grows.
Mm-hmm. Right.
When we do what is right and good and pleasing to God, while the world does what is right in their own eyes and pleasing to them, that's a culture conflict, right? The evidence is not visible when the world is coincidentally doing what happens to be God's good.
Mm-hmm.
That happens once in a while. You know, they say a broken clock, even
a broken clock is right twice a day.
Thank you, my trusted assistant. In America today, like a lot of the other Western nations, sexual immorality, including pornography, adultery, homosexuality, and fornication, and cursing, and on and on and on, are totally acceptable to the majority of people. So much so that it is now clear that it's considered evil to disagree with the same majority.
Yeah.
I see this over and over and over. If you call sin, sin, you're the one doing evil.
That's right.
How upside down can you get? Culture comes from the word, same word, cultivated. And God created man to cultivate, by the way.
Yes,
he formed Adam out of the dust of the earth and he put him in the garden to cultivate it. We were designed to cultivate. But cultivating is nurturing something, forming it so it grows in the direction you want it to grow, right? Remember what Paul wrote to Timothy, in last perilous last days, men would be lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. A few years ago, I was doing this study on the evidence of a redeemed life, and a movie had just come out called The Wolf of Wall Street. You probably have heard of it.
We have, yeah.
That film, made in 2013, was so filled with nudity, graphic sexual scenes, violence, drug use, and cursing that after it was completed, totally finished, it had to be re-edited to remove some of the profanity and sex scenes to avoid an NC-17 rating, which would have meant that it wouldn't have made it into a lot of theaters, right? But it proudly and boastfully set a record for the use of the F word. The film centered on greed, which God calls idolatry, by the way. That film was banned in Kenya. It was banned in Malaysia. It was banned in Nepal. Yet it still earned $250 million in its first month out in the Western world. What did the community think of it? What did America think of it? What did England think? What did they think of it? Well, I'll tell you. It was nominated for the best motion picture in its 2014 Golden Globes. It has already won 16 major awards, and it was nominated for 5 Academy Awards in March 2014. That's what the world thought of it. They celebrated the sin. That's the culture of the world. That's the morality of the world. That's what's acceptable to them.
Yes.
I promise you, no matter how many people find it acceptable, God never will.
No.
That next year in the Grammy Awards. Now that's a tribute to music, right?
Mm-hmm.
That took place a couple of years ago now, I guess. And it was notable for live performances that should have, but did not, make the camera blush. I don't know if cameras can blush. Along with all of the raunchiness, a mass marriage ceremony took place at the Grammy Awards. What's up with that? 34 couples, including many homosexual couples, took part on live TV as a song was performed about same-sex relations by the winners of the award for the Best New Artist category. I'd like to share some of the lyrics from the songs from some of the winners, just so you can see what the world is doing, but I can't. Because if I did, my mommy would wash my mouth out with soap. The New York Times reported that a performance by one man on the show, the show's headline song, kept the network censor busy silencing curse words. That's music. I somehow, you know, you can call me old-fashioned, and they'll never hurt my feelings. I can't picture Perry Como shouting some of these things at the top of his lungs. I promise you that. In my lifetime, now you may think I'm getting pretty old, but I'm still a child of God. I have seen what God calls sin, so much of it. Take homosexuality, for example. Go from being prohibited, which it was,
mm-hmm.
to being permitted, to being protected, and now to being promoted in my lifetime.
Yes.
All that being said, I need to remind myself, and this is important, that the purpose of this study is not to examine those individuals who spew filth to the applause of the masses, but rather for you and me to examine ourselves.
Yes.
Our purpose here is to see to what extent, if any, we have been influenced to accept or to imitate the behavior that surrounds our daily lives. This is really the question. You know, it's hard to imagine you can swim in a cesspool and come out without stinking.
Mm-hmm. Most definitely.
And yet, praise God, we have been sealed by the Holy Spirit.
Thank you, Lord.
We have a helmet of salvation to protect our minds. We have the power to take thoughts captive to the obedience of Christ. We can walk through this world and be in the world, but not of it. We can walk through this life unscathed by the slings and arrows of the enemy. When you walk according to the command of God, when you walk within that righteousness that He has given us, when we walk that path of righteousness, He will protect us. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. He's given us the armor.
But you need to be on guard. You need to be on guard. And that's what I want to talk about. I think we're going to go, and like I said, you know, morality is determined either by the community, by the individual, or by God. So in our next session, we're going to look at the individual.
Yes.
Because remember, when it comes to morality, it says in Judges a few times, when there was no king in Israel, every man did what was right in his own eyes. Always your own judge.
Yes.
Remember how I started? Jesus said, the word I spoke will judge you on the last day. So please be back with us the next time. Continue on as we study this and look at this. So we grow. We get greater revelation of God's plan and purpose in our lives. And Father, we thank you, Lord, that you have protected us, that you have sealed us, and that you have given us instruction on how to live the fullness of life, Lord God, a pure and holy life pleasing to you, that we might be empowered to do good, that you might be glorified through it.
Hallelujah.
We pray that we do those things, Father, in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. Well, till next time, God bless you, God and bless goodbye. You. Bye-bye.
I will cling to that old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Thank you.